So good evening. I'm Dr. Benjamin Richards, visiting assistant professor of philosophy here at Eastern University. Tonight, it is my pleasure, on behalf of the Agora Institute for Civic Virtue and the Common Good, to welcome and introduce our speaker, Dr. John Haldane. John Haldane is the J. Newton Razor Senior Distinguished Professor of Philosophy at Baylor University. Dr. Haldane is also Professor of Moral Philosophy and Senior Fellow of the Center of Ethics, Philosophy, and Public Affairs, the University of St. Andrews, as well as Senior Fellow of the Witherspoon Institute in Princeton, Senior Fellow of the Center for Ethics and Culture at the University of Notre Dame, Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Chair of the Royal Institute of Philosophy in London, and Consultant to the Pontifical Council for Culture at the Vatican. He was recently named by Best Schools as one of the 50 most influential living philosophers. John Haldane is the co-author of Atheism and Theism, listed in Blackwell's Tomorrow's Classics list, and author of The Intelligent Person's Guide to Religion. He's produced two volumes of essays on philosophy and religion entitled Faithful Reason and Reasonable Faith, both published by Routledge, and a volume on ethics entitled Practical Philosophy. He's also published two collections intended for general readers, Seeking Meaning and Making Sense and The Church and the World. Dr. Haldane has published some 200 academic papers on topics in the history of philosophy, philosophy of mind, metaphysics, and moral and social philosophy. He's credited with coining the designation analytical Thomism, which has come to describe an approach to philosophical questions of which he is the key proponent. According to Dr. Haldane, analytical Thomism involves the bringing into mutual relationship of the styles and preoccupations of recent English-speaking philosophy and the ideas and concerns shared by St. Thomas and his followers. The benefit of such mutual understanding can be seen in Dr. Haldane's twofold conviction that, on the one hand, there is at the heart of Catholic theology a commitment to the idea that the world is not of our making, that it is intrinsically intelligible, that truth is absolute and not relative, and that reason has the power to establish these facts, and that, on the other hand, these ideas receive a warmer reception within the world of analytic philosophy than they do within that of post-structuralist postmodernism. Accordingly, like Aquinas, Dr. Haldane feels no deep and fundamental tension between faith and reason. It is obvious thereby that Dr. Haldane is well chosen to meet the Agora Institute's mission of facilitating public discourse about civic virtue and the common good. Before I turn the floor over to Dr. Haldane, I would like to mention, in closing, my personal debt of gratitude to Dr. Haldane with regard to my own intellectual formation. In addition to his numerous scholarly activities, Dr. Haldane is concerned both with speaking to wider non-academic audiences through various periodicals, through television and radio programs, as well as with the formation of young scholars. I had the pleasure of attending one of Dr. Haldane's Thomistic seminars at the Witherspoon Institute in Princeton when I was a graduate student. Dr. Haldane served as a helpful model to me for how I might go about integrating my own philosophical work more fully with the perennial concerns and questions raised by St. Thomas, that universal teacher of a still undivided Western Christianity. And I hope that I've come to model those same qualities to my students here at Eastern. So, without further ado, please welcome John Haldane, who is here to speak with us tonight about how we understand and deal with societal conflict.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for that gracious and handsome tribute. You can use it in obituary so when the day is needed, right? In fact, I was yesterday. I've just come from Princeton, and last night there was a celebration of the work of Sir Roger Scruton, and so Scruton was there, and several of us had been asked to form a panel and discuss aspects of his work, and I was going to say that it's very difficult to strike the right note on these occasions, somewhere on the scale between a reference and an obituary. And then I looked at Scruton and thought, probably won't bother saying that. So there's a line. He was looking a bit shaky. So there was a line I thought I would use, but then decided not to. So thank you very much. I'm pleased to be here. I thoroughly approve of the work, the role that the Agora Institute has taken as providing a public forum with its mission to facilitate free and open inquiry and exchange of ideas. And so this evening is going to, I hope, be an instantiation of those concerns. Sorry, are you hearing me at the back? Yeah. I once gave a lecture in which I spoke, as I will tonight, for about 2 hours, and at the end of it, the first question came from the back, and the chap said, I didn't hear what you said, and I wasn't quite sure this was an invitation to just give him another 2 hours, but you must stop me. If it gets anywhere near over 2.5 hours, that's the point at which you're over. So I understand that I have 40 minutes to sort out the troubles of the world, is that correct? Yeah, so deep breath, and here we go. So the title is Understanding and Dealing with Societal Conflict. I think I'm probably going to have more to say about understanding societal conflict than dealing. I mean, I will address the question of dealing with it, but if you've come here in the hope of a solution, then you might want to leave now. I will say something about possible forms of solutions, though I think it's a feature of the depth of the challenges that we face that there is no easy answer to quite how we proceed now. Differences need not always give rise to disagreements, let alone to conflicts. But for various reasons which I'm going to be discussing, we now live in societies that are divided over particular moral and public policy issues, of course, but also, and more extensively, over fundamental conceptions of personal and societal goods. And I think that is really part of the challenge. It's not just that we've got localized issues between us, it's that something more extensive has happened. And it's that separates people very profoundly. So the first thing I want to say is that to address these issues, before we have a chance of addressing these issues, we first of all have to understand them. Now let me begin by quoting G.K. Chesterton. Who was a wonderful prose stylist and a very insightful person, delivered to his publisher, Castle, a book entitled What's Wrong with the World? It was published in 1908. And Castle, the publisher's... in his original typescript, he had a question mark, What's Wrong with the World? Question mark. But the publishers thought it would sell better if they took away the question mark, so it sounded like this was going to be resounding declaration of what's wrong with the world. But in fact, it is somewhat tentative in some respects. But it's very interesting that how he begins this book, it's divided into parts, and then the parts are divided into chapters. So part one of this book, published in 1908, so effectively 110 years, that's right, isn't it? Yeah, 110 years old. The first part is titled The Homelessness of Man, and the first chapter of that first part is entitled The Medical Mistake. So I'm going to begin just by quoting Chesterton. He says this, "A book of modern social inquiry has a shape that is somewhat sharply defined. It begins, as a rule, with an analysis and ends with a chapter that is generally called The Remedy. This scheme of medical question and answer is a blunder. It's always called stating the disease before we find the cure. But it's the whole definition and dignity of man that in social matters we must actually find the cure before we find the disease." And he explains what he means by this, how that could be the case. How could we find the cure before we knew what the disease was? Well, he continues, "We don't disagree like doctors about the precise nature of the illness while agreeing about the nature of health. On the contrary, we all agree that the country is, say, unhealthy, but not on what true health is. The only way to discuss the social evil is to get at once to the social ideal. What is wrong with the world is that we don't ask what's right." Now, I think this is a very insightful observation, really. I mean, what he's saying is that in certain aspects of, say, biology or whatever it is, there's agreement on what proper functioning is. And so it's just a question of how you address this lame animal or the animal that's diseased in various ways and so on. But when it turns to human affairs, part of the disagreement is about what constitutes health, as it were, right? What constitutes a good kind of life. And that's part of the difficulty that we face. So why are we in this situation? What's the nature of our difficulty and what are the origins of it? So I'm going to be talking for a little while now about that in answer to that question or that set of questions. And the first thing I want to say is that actually, let's begin with an observation where we are. There is clearly very widespread disagreement. I divide my life now between the United States and Scotland, and Scotland is sort of doubly conflicted in a way, because on the one hand there's a question as to whether or not it's going to remain part of the United Kingdom, so there's that debate. But then there's the question about what Britain's future is going to be as it leaves the European Union. And these two questions have deeply divided the country. I mean, Scotland and the United Kingdom more generally. The Brexit vote was very close, and so many people, who were up to that point proud advocates of democracy, think it might be time to have a second vote. Just keep voting until the people get the right answer. So that's one aspect of it, the division over Brexit. But then, as I say, within the United Kingdom, we have a division over the future of that kingdom. I think myself that that problem will intensify with the death of the Queen. One thing that's very interesting for most of us is that, I mean, the present sovereign was reigning before I was born. And most people in Britain have grown up with this person as their figurehead, as their sovereign. And she is a tremendously sort of binding quality. People just can't imagine what it'd be like, when she's gone and so on. And I think that it will further expose the sense of a lack of unity. So you've got a country that's divided over whether it should be part of Europe or not, or at least part of the European Union or not. You've got a country that's divided over whether it should be a united state, as it were, between Scotland and England and so on. And institutions like the Crown are quite important because they represent stability and a kind of transcendent stability, because the Queen, or the sovereign, is a constitutional sovereign. They're above party politics. And it's about the one institution that hasn't really been seriously politicized and made a subject of debate. Obviously, there are Republicans and so on, but that institution is extremely important in times of difficulty, as was shown by the history of the Second World War, the First World War, and so on. And I think it really will expose further the divisions within the country when the Queen dies, because, first of all, it will just mark the end of something, and then people will raise the question, well, is it time to become a republic? So that issue will be on the agenda in a way it isn't at present. Prince Charles is not particularly popular, so there's a question as to quite who will ascend to the throne. He will ascend to the throne. There's no possibility of skipping a generation. Prince William, I don't think, wants the job, but I mean, at some stage he will have to serve in that capacity. But it is going to be a very interesting moment. Now, I need hardly remind you that here in the United States, there are a set of issues that have divided you quite recently and continue to divide you and will continue to divide you around the elections of last year. And of course, as well as the ongoing coverage of one aspect or another of all of this, you'll soon be facing another round of midterm elections, and we'll see what that does to further unsettle things. The New York Times produced at one point a political map of the United States. Some of you may remember seeing this, but it's very illuminating. One of the debates around the presidential election was, as it were, the question, who won? And of course the dispute over the Electoral College on the one hand, the general aggregated vote on the other, and so on. But the really interesting thing to look at is voting by county. And when you look at the county map of the United States, one thing that emerges very dramatically is the difference between Hillary Clinton's America and Donald Trump's America. And Hillary Clinton's America essentially are coastal strips on the west and east, plus a number of other cities, Austin, Chicago, and so on. But the mass of American counties voted for Trump. There's a further map which is very interesting, which is an arrow map, which shows the direction of change of vote from the last election. And the interesting thing about that is the arrows are all moving in the Republican direction in all of those counties. So it's, the idea that this was a sort of temporary phenomenon, I think, is unsettled by these maps. Now, these maps correspond, logically speaking, to the Brexit map. If you look at the Brexit map by constituency, it was a general referendum, so people didn't vote by constituency, but they used the polling booths that they normally use for elections to constituencies, like congressional elections. So you can break down the vote by voting area, which correspond to historical constituencies. And Again, when you look at that map, what you find is that I think are very interesting because they reveal the geographical and cultural nature of the difference. What you have are metropolitan centres, post-industrial metropolitan centres that are generally non-productive except outside of the service industries and so on, and then the sort of historic heartlands of farming and many of them deindustrialised but industrial areas and so on. And the same is true in Britain. So you've got a very... There are many ways of cutting up the country now, and both the United States and the United Kingdom, but one way of doing it is by the character and experiences and ambitions of people who inhabit the cities, particularly the principal metropolitan centres, and people who inhabit smaller towns and so on. And of course that is, and unsurprisingly to some extent, a contrast between liberal cosmopolitanism on the one hand and a certain kind of local rooted conservatism on the other. Now, this is just one aspect of the kind of dividedness. It's one that's easy to illustrate because of these voting maps. And one question you might have is, can America be put back together again? Could you have a voting map in 4 years' time or 8 years' time and so on that didn't look like the one that the New York Times produced, or again in Britain? And are these tendencies intensifying? I spent a certain amount of time in continental Europe. Belgium is deeply divided between Flanders in the north, Wallonia in the south. There's a the Party of the North in Italy. Some of you may know about that. There's the secessionist movements in not only the north of Spain, but in the south of France. Europe is deeply divided, and there's a real prospect, particularly, I think, if Britain leaves the European Union, which it clearly is going to do, of a kind of balkanization of aspects of Europe and a breakdown of these into, in part, more traditional, rural, southern, for the most part, areas, and then northern post-industrial metropolitan centres with very high levels of immigration. It's another, of course, aspect of all of this. So there's a lot that challenges us. Now, the question is, that's one kind of set of facts. And then we've got all these disagreements about particular issues. Disagreements about immigration, obviously, here in the United States and in Europe. Disagreements about the place of religion in society. Disagreements around issues like same-sex marriage or abortion or euthanasia, whatever the list would be. And they just go on and on. A whole new set of issues around genetic engineering and one parent generation using techniques and so on, surrogate wombs, all of this kind of stuff. It just really goes on and on and on. Now, you could have all of those issues, but not disagreement, right? I mean, it could be that there are issues that face us, but there was consensus. So why isn't there consensus? What's the nature of the difficulty here? Now, I think that you can't answer that question in any illuminating way without making reference to history. So although I'm a philosopher, the first thing I'm going to say is that philosophy alone isn't going to help us to understand or resolve these issues. Or if I'm going to say philosophy can do a lot of it, it'll only be to the extent that philosophy appropriates some other subjects. It's only to the extent that philosophy takes history seriously in a way that many philosophers tend not to do. Or economics, for that matter, seriously in a way that philosophers often tend not to do, or just ignore it. It's only if we take those seriously that we can arrive at any kind of integrated explanatory account of what's going on. Now, taking history seriously, I think, has two aspects or elements to it. One is actually just looking at the history. But the other aspect is philosophical. It's understanding the extent to which the philosophical ideas that we have are themselves historical products. And I'm going to come back and say a bit more about that in a minute. But let me just begin with history. It's one of those, for the historically minded, and if there are any historians or people who have studied history in the room, they'll know, what the temptations are. When you start to tell the history, you say things like, well, you really have to go back to that. Well, no, actually, you'd have to go a bit back behind that. Well, Now I come to think of it, and then you're sort of, you're in the Middle Ages, right? So we started off in 1945, and then you thought, nah, that won't do it. 1970, well, Franco-Prussian, no, probably, and then, right, get it? And also, of course, the legacy of history continues. I mean, the very notion of history, in a sense, is, you know, it's an abstraction, and it can lead us into sort of thinking that was then and this is now. But, of course, there isn't any division between then and, I mean, it's just a continuous flow in one way or another. But you remember, it was, I can't remember, I think it was Chu Enlai, one of the Chinese leaders and so on, who, when he was asked what he thought about the French Revolution, said it was too early to say. Now, that's a joke, sorry. You know, the events at the end of the 18th century are still being received, as it were, in the present day. So let me start to say something about history. And it's this, that I think one cannot understand the rise of liberalism, not as a philosophical theory, though something to be said about that as well, but as it were, as a lived politics, save against the background of the Second World War. And one can't really understand the context of the Second World War without understanding that of the First World War. And there, here we go. And then maybe the Franco-Prussian, no, we won't go down the Franco-Prussian War. Right, so what's the significance of this? Well, here's the significance of it. It's pretty, I'm going to have to go back just a little bit more. Right, so the modern state is a very recent invention. It's an invention of the 19th century. It's worth bearing in mind that most European countries, modern European countries, didn't exist before 1850. They are products of, I mean, they, you know, I don't mean that sort of the stuff rose up out of the sea. What I mean is that the geopolitical states that we're dealing with are modern creations. Italy is a modern creation. Germany is a modern, is a 19th century creation. Belgium is a complete fiction. I mean, there, it doesn't correspond to, this is serious. It doesn't correspond to, I mean, it's not a linguistic unity. It's not a cultural unity. It's French-speaking in the south. It's Flemish in the north. Maybe people don't know this. Flanders was part of the Spanish Empire, right? And, of course, imperial history has got a lot to do with this. These highly artificial boundaries often just marked, you know, as far as you got your army, right? Or where you were pushed back or whatever else it may be. So one thing that happens in the 19th century is the attempt to create out of the chaos of the legacy of things like the Holy Roman Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire, states, political entities. And so Germany is born. Poland, Lithuania particularly, sort of sad case really. I mean, it's a, I have to be in Lithuania again in, later this year, I can't remember, but I was there a couple of years ago. It's very interesting. In Lithuania, if you're looking at any historical documents, they'll appear in four different languages because Lithuania has just been marched across to and fro, you know, by different peoples. They renamed things in one thing and another and so on. But this is actually quite common in Europe. And it's worth saying that most European countries, well, first of all, most European countries are modern creations in the form in which we have them today. But secondly, most European countries, I mean continental European countries, have experienced defeat within the memories of people still alive today. So if you're in France, your parents, or more likely your grandparents, saw German troops march across France. Obviously Germany saw the troops of Russia and the Allied forces and so on. But you just think about the European countries' defeat in war, Italy and so on. And then even the countries that were not, that stood apart in some way or another, tended to themselves to be subject to totalitarian regimes, if you think of Spain and Portugal and so on. So the seeds or the roots of democracy do not go deep in Europe. And I think it's very tempting to think that Europe is the homeland of democracy. It isn't really. I mean, I'm not talking about Greek democracy, I'm talking about modern political democracy. Modern political democracy has hardly taken root in Europe. And the strong counter-democratic forces are present in Europe. Not that, I don't mean from a particular source, I'm not talking about sort of, you know, neo-fascists or that sort of thing, though that may be a manifestation of it. It's the sense that democracy is entirely unproven in continental Europe. This is one reason why so many of the European countries are concerned about the possible breakup of the European Union, because the European Union is the first experience they've had of stable government. Right? It's an external administrative state, which has indeed produced a kind of stability across Europe. Now, the significance of all of this is that there is a great deal of anxiety and mistrust of the past in Europe, because the past is not a happy one, right? I think it's natural for people, say, in the United States, to look at Europe and think of the old countries of Europe and think of the traditions of Europe and, you know, how wonderful all of this is. But actually, that's the sort of picture postcard Europe. The reality of political Europe for the last 200 years is one of unsettlement, revolution, war, and so on. So one thing, and then, of course, of you know, the totalitarianism of ideologies. So one thing that's happened in Europe, which was in part productive of these wars, were the old tensions between the imperial powers that gave rise to the First World War, then were unresolved by the Treaty of Versailles, and everybody knew that another war was coming. So the period between 1918 and 1938, 38-39, was really one of simply waiting for that war to be resumed or to be taken up again. So that was an enormous period of lack of stability and settlement. America, of course, was drawn into the First World War, and one argument for American isolationism, or non-intervention, depending what you want to call it, is, look, these are not wars not of our making. Why should we get ourselves involved in them? And, of course, the other thing is that many of these ethnic identities were represented in the United States, Italians, Germans, French, and so on and such like. So, you know, if we intervene on one side, then we're going to alienate part of our population. But America did come to Europe's rescue, twice, of course. But it cost America a lot, not just economically. I think it actually had a really traumatizing effect on large sections of America, because people were drawn, because these were world wars. So people were drawn off the land across the United States and found themselves abroad and fighting in wars that they didn't really, you know, see much point in, and so on. And so what this contributes to is something that really began with the First World War, which is disillusionment with any kind of established order. The idea that you could rely upon traditional forms of political association or whatever else it might be, as states or nationhood or whatever else it may be, as a kind of ground of political stability, that belief, that hope evaporated as that ground gave way, right? The monarchies of Europe gave way. This kind of peace that the empires were supposed to have established gave way, and so on. So the first thing I want to say is that we now are living in a period that comes at the end of a century that, you know, is one of the most disturbing and unsettling in the experience of Europe. And all the grand plans of building nation states and so on were rather shattered in that period. It's worth adding also that part of the disillusionment was, both in Britain and in Germany, was the idea that culture or civilization had reached an unparalleled peak in those countries at that time. So they saw themselves as, in a way, enjoying the fruits of civilization and culture. And yet these two most civilized, cultured nations then ended up at war with one another and tore one another apart. And of course destroyed the leadership class in those societies through, and not only the leadership class, but certainly the leadership class. Now, when you come to the period of 1945 or the following that, something happens in Britain that happened in America and also happened to a lesser degree after the First World War, but particularly in the end of the Second World War, there was the feeling that something was owed to these troops who'd gone off to fight, particularly, say, in the United States. And so you get things like the GI Bill and the development of mass higher education and a kind of transformation. But the other thing that you get, which you'd got in Britain and elsewhere in Europe in the period between the First and Second World Wars, is a sense of partying, right? That actually we've had a rough old time, we're not sure what the future holds, now's the time to kind of, you know, enjoy ourselves a bit. And I think you can't really understand, say, the beat culture in California of the late 1950s, save against the background of what had been the experience of those people serving in wars abroad and so on. And then, of course, out of the beat culture then comes the Cultural Revolution of the 1960s in California and correspondingly in Paris and so on. Now, unsurprisingly, if you're in a period of rebellion, what do you rebel against? Well, pre-established forms, right? So one thing that you do is to try to sort of cast off the idea of forms of life that are inherited, because those have failed, right? So the traditional forms have failed and then are subjected to a kind of acidic attack as being illusions. And of course, this critique is then intensified by cultural Marxism, by attempts to try to see what's going on in terms of concealed forces of power and one thing and another. And so that narrative, the cultural Marxist narrative, not always represented under the name of Marxism, then with the expansion of higher education, finds root in the social sciences and so on, in universities and colleges and so on. And so these ideas are now become widespread, compounded by a degree of kind of Nietzscheanism, Freudianism, and so on. The idea that of the what later comes to be called the hermeneutic of suspicion, right? That when somebody says something, you ask yourself the question, Lenin's question, why are they saying it? Who's saying it? Why are they saying it now? Right? So you become, as it were, critical of your culture. And every attempt to try to establish or reestablish, particularly to reestablish values, is seen as an instrument of oppression, right? So it's part of the task of the radical or the social critic to expose power for what it is. And of course, power seeks to express itself in the form of legitimacy, whether that be, say, a crown, I mean, a sovereign or something of that sort. That's why, you know, in an earlier period, you have these debates about things like the divine right of kings, right? That's a way of sort of establishing legitimacy for a power structure. Well, that's how you might see this and so on. So the rise of, compounding that, if we think of sort of the easy availability, for example, of oral contraceptives and the entry of women into the workforce, that changes the nature of people's self-conception and their relation to work and to home. So it's not surprising that you find a series of moves, not quite in parallel, but as it were, keeping pace with one another, which is the rise of no-fault divorce, the easy availability of oral contraceptives, the rise of abortion as a kind of second preventative measure, as it were, and the breakdown of the traditional family unit, or what's conceived of as being the traditional family unit. Just to give a sense of, you know, where how far we've come, in 19th century Britain, and indeed into the early part of the 20th century, if you wanted a divorce in Great Britain, that required an act of Parliament, right? So if A wanted to divorce B, certainly if they were married in the Church of England, which for legal reasons I won't go into now, but a marriage in the church, because it's an established church, that is a legally, not just religiously or sacramentally valid marriage, it's a legally valid marriage. That's not true if you marry as just two Methodists gone to go some sort of Methodist ceremony, or Roman Catholics for that matter. These are not legally valid marriages. They may be canonically valid marriages, but not legally valid marriages. In the Church of England, these are legally valid marriages because it's an established church, it's part of the state. So what that meant was that if you wanted to divorce, you needed a piece of law to be passed. That piece of law could be passed either in a canon court, a church court, or more typically, because there'd be property divisions and various things going on, it was an act of Parliament actually dissolving the union. So it won't surprise you to know that the kind of people who got divorced in Britain into the early part of the 20th century tended to be very wealthy aristocrats, right? It wasn't something that in general, you know, try and get an act of Parliament done if you're just Mr. Smith from, you know, Newark, New Jersey, let's say. Okay. I have to be careful there. Think about how where we've gone from that idea, right, that actually the legal indissolubility, effectively, for most people of marriage, through to a situation of no-fault divorce. And think of the way in which relations of that sort are mediated by and impacted by things like deindustrialization, where men are no longer doing heavy work, as it were, and the rise of service industries. And so women's entry into the workforce and service industries, and of course, if you're in work, and maybe you're the only earner in the family, particularly if you think of the Rust Belts in the US, along the Ohio River Valley and so on, then pregnancy is a threat to employment, right? So that kind of produces a further ratcheting up of the avoidance of pregnancy and of family, which in turn feeds things like abortion rates and so on. So these are the kind of forces, and one could continue with all of this, but these are the kind of forces that have contributed in part to the kind of society we have. Now, how does this impact upon liberalism? Well, how does it contribute to liberalism? Pretty clearly, because in these circumstances, you want, insofar as is possible, you're trying to make a good life for yourself in circumstances in which traditional forms, inherited forms of social life and so on, have either been destroyed by war or been seen to be illusions in some way, as the critical theorists are going to say, or are just breaking down under the pressure of things like deindustrialization, the entry of women into the workforce, and the kinds of things I've been talking about. And of course, people having to travel further and further away from home to find employment, and so people are distributed around, so there isn't the intergenerational structural support that traditionally you had, and so on. Well, in these circumstances, you want to do the best you can to try to make a life for yourself. And you're going to have to negotiate that under the conditions in which you find yourself. So you really want to minimize the set of social constraints that you're subject to. Right? So it's unsurprising that people start to think of the good life as essentially a life that people make for themselves, unencumbered by the expectations of others. And so you get a kind of individualizing liberalism. And of course, if you obviously, under the conditions I've just described, you're going to want more liberal divorce laws, right? You're going to want the decriminalization of abortion. You're going to want, and so on and such like. This is part of the story. Now, let me switch to the second part of the story. I said it'd be 3 hours, okay? So the second part of the story goes something like this. Some of you will know, and particularly people who are conservative by disposition, will perhaps know and celebrate the work of somebody called Richard Weaver. Weaver wrote a book called Ideas Have Consequences. And that title sort of entered really as a kind of slogan. What he had in mind was, look, all these kind of lifestyle liberals in the 1960s in California or in the late 1950s in California and so on, I mean, or say the kinds of things that were being said on college campuses at a certain point in the cultural revolutions of the 1960s. You know, it's be careful what you say. These things sound fine, you know. But ideas have consequences, right? If you start to say, look, you can live any way you like, well, people might start to live any way they like, and that will have consequences. So ideas have consequences. Ideas are not inert. They're not just playthings, right? If they get into people's minds, particularly through education, then they have consequences, and that will affect how people live. Now, that is certainly true, but I also think there's a certain shallowness in this, because I want to say that actually ideas are consequences. Right, ideas are consequences of the way we live. So let me quote you one of the great insights of philosophy, or so I believe. This comes in Hegel's preface to the philosophy of right, and he repeats it actually in the main body of the text, but he says, it's good this, you're probably going to want this on your gravestone, so you better write it down, right? When philosophy paints its grey on grey, then has a form of life grown old. By means of philosophy's grey on grey, it can only be understood, it cannot be rejuvenated. Say it again, because it is good. When philosophy paints its grey on grey, then has a form of life grown old. By means of philosophy's grey on grey, it can only be understood, it cannot be rejuvenated or reanimated. So what did he mean? Well, first of all, the image of grey on grey is very nice. I mean, before I was a philosopher, I was an artist, so I spent 5 years doing fine art, and taught art, actually. But at any rate, so what you have to imagine here is a painter, you know, who's... So you will know, some of you, that paintbrushes are graded by size, right? So there are big paintbrushes and there are finer paintbrushes. But when you really get into the kind of fine detail and stuff, you know, you've got paintbrushes that are about two hairs in the brush. You know, that's an exaggeration, okay? But so really fine, okay? And then if you have a subtle color palette, as we are to say, you're discriminating very subtle shades that nobody else is kind of up to recognizing the difference between. You know, you've got people who can barely tell red from yellow, right? And you've identified 1,000 shades of orange or something of this sort, okay? So you have to imagine the artist, you know, with his two-haired brush and his 50 shades of grey. I didn't quite intend that, but anyway. His 65 shades of grey, all right, who is there up at his, and he's going blind because he's got these sort of, you know, binoculars on because his eyes are so worn out. And he's painting in his little shades of grey, right? And of course, the point is that for anybody who's just standing 2 feet back, it's just grey, right? So when philosophy paints its grey and grey, what it means is when it's down to the fine details of the kinds of things that philosophers really like to do, you know, wherever you give me a distinction, I'll make a distinction within that distinction, you know. And this is a kind of philosopher's pride for any distinction, however proximate the parts, I can divide that into a further distinction, okay? So that's like grey and grey, right? So when philosophy is getting involved in the details, then has a form of life grown old? So by the time that philosophy gets round to understanding it, it's already happened. And by means of philosophy, it can only be understood. It cannot be reanimated. So by the time that philosophy understands the phenomenon is no longer alive. It's a fossil, right? It's something that we can understand it, and it's worth understanding it. But Hegel's view of philosophy in relation to history and to events is that it's important to understand, now I'm going to sort of put words into his mouth, that in the beginning was not the word, but the deed, right? I mean, the word or the idea is a recapitulation at the level of intellect or reason of something whose first life was at the level of action. So our ideas keep track of our lives. Our lives are not so much animated by ideas as give rise to ideas. Now, of course, the movement is in two directions. I'm not denying that ideas can influence people's thinking, but what I'm saying is that the ideas that we have, it's always worth asking yourself the question, why do we have that idea? Now, I'll just give two illustrations of this, where cases where it looks like a philosopher is coming up with an idea, and then it sort of informs people's thinking and it shapes their lives and so on, but where in fact the idea is a result of the context in which the philosopher is working, the lived realities of that context. So John Stuart Mill, for example, who's famously associated with utilitarianism, clearly, one of the objections to utilitarianism that you will hear is that the utilitarian overlooks aspects of motivation or character, but the utilitarian neglects virtue. Well, what do we find John Stuart Mill saying? He says, it matters not only what men do, but what manner of men they are that do it. Right? This is surprising, you might think, from a utilitarian. It matters not only what men do, but what manner of men they are that do it. Mill was, in fact, very concerned with virtue. And the reason that he came upon this thought was that he was actually in the process of designing the civil service exam. Mill had worked for the East India Company, which then becomes, or the legacy of the East India Company, which becomes part of the British Imperial trading presence in India and so on. In that period, what you were trying to work was how to train people who were going to carry on the business of imperial administration. Because you're talking about a period prior to telegrams and things of that sort. So they're going to have to deal with issues on the ground. And they can't just keep saying, sending a boat back to London to work out what you're supposed to do. So Mill's insight was, if you want people to do the right thing, don't give them rules, habituate them, right? It matters not only what men do, but what manner of men they are that do it. Shape people to be certain kinds of people. Now, admittedly, he wanted them to be utility maximizers, but shape people to be certain kinds of, to be certain kinds of agents. And I don't think that you can understand Mill's utilitarianism and his writings around that subject independently of understanding the role that he had in fashioning what becomes the modern British civil service, or his contribution to that, and the context of imperial British rule. Second example, an earlier example, is Locke. Locke is sometimes avowed and identified as being an important figure in the theory of rights, and the development of the theory of rights. Locke was responsible for he was, again, a kind of civil servant, but he working within the Treasury at one point. He was responsible for managing aspects of colonial trade, right? The trade between the Americas and the Crown. And he was very interested in questions of taxation, issues that 100 years later would occasion the American Revolution, right? But he was very interested in these questions of taxation and so on. And Locke's theory of rights and property, which is sometimes traced through Richard Hooker, the Anglican divine, back to Aquinas and so on, and is seen as deep theory, I think is as well explained, and in some respects more interestingly explained, in terms of Locke's dealings with what was a contemporary issue, which was to do with the taxation of the colonies. And so this got him thinking in certain ways and so on. So I'm offering these as illustrations of which philosophical ideas that seem to just, as it were, you know, they're the abstract artifacts of sheer genius or something of that sort, are actually solutions to practical problems. And in the solution to these practical problems, people fashion concepts. So you might say that the concept of a right, as it features in Locke or is developed out of Locke and so on, is actually a manifestation or expression at the intellectual level of something that was being driven at the practical level, the level of agency. It was actually to do with the trading relations between the American colonies and the crown in Great Britain and so on. So I want to generalize this and to say that if we're going to understand our present-day conflicts, we have to understand both the history that's brought us to where we are, but also the fact that the ideas we have about ourselves and how we might be related to one another in our political and social and moral dealings with one another are themselves products of that history. Right? These ideas don't just descend from some Platonic heaven. These concepts are instruments or tools that have been fashioned out of practice. Now, I'm not saying that practice is not, that has no reason in it. I mean, reason is not present in it. But the way in which reason is imminent within practice, to use that language, is as unself-conscious operation. So, you know, think of a child learning to walk, right? I mean, it has a certain command of its limbs. But it would only be much later in life, if ever, that it was in a position to actually give you a narrative that explained its capacity to walk, in terms of counterbalance and one thing and another, right? So these notions that we are, as were, our first form of reasoned life is not as articulated reason, it's as immanent reason. It's reason as part of our natural animation, if you like, okay? So speech, for example, would just be a case in point. You know, human beings naturally come to a point of speech, not by themselves. They've got to be socially triggered, environmentally triggered in various ways and so on. But you speak long before, as it were, you understand anything about language itself as an object of grammatical or theoretical study and so on. And some people never come to that understanding. So what I'm saying is that part of our ideas are the, you know, have come to the surface and been fashioned and shaped in the process of rising through the depths. But where they rise up from is practice, social practice. And so, if we are to understand why we have the thoughts that we have on either side of some of these contentious debates, it's a mistake to think that these thoughts are pure philosophical concepts. They're actually products of social interactions. They're products of history. And I don't think we can really understand the abortion debates and why that debate has arisen, save against the background of such things as the entry of women into the workforce, the beginning of the dissolution of the traditional family, the shift away from hard manual labor and various other sorts of things. So these have behind them the notion, for example, of reproductive rights or control over your own body and so on is a very, it's an interesting concept. It's, I mean, whether it's philosophically coherent, I mean, the idea that we own our bodies is itself a rather interesting question, because it just seems a very odd thing to own your body, right? You don't say, well, I don't own my body. I am my body, right? And what's this stuff about owning my body? But you can see how you might want to make ownership claims over your body, deploy this rather strange concept, in order to limit other people's access to your body and use of your body and the way in which things happen to your body. So laying ownership rights to your body is the sort of idea you'd come up with if you were living a life in which you wanted to be able to do certain things. And so you claim a right to do those things as a property right. Right? Now, I'm not trying to resolve the question of abortion. I'm just pointing out that the way in which we think about these things is as I'm inclined to say, as plausibly or perhaps more plausibly explained by looking at the social circumstances out of which these ideas and debates arose. Okay. When did I start? How long have I got left? An hour and a half? 5 minutes? 10 minutes? 5 minutes? 10 minutes. Is that all right? I can't remember what time we started. Sorry. Was it 10? Sorry? 7:35, I think, because I was sitting there. Because then I know it. All right. It was all right. 5 minutes. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. 50 minutes. Yeah, fine. I'm going deaf. I thought I'd heard you say 50 minutes, right? So now I want to say a bit more about this. Not about what I've said already, but move on. So here's a feature, which is a deeply ironic feature of contemporary arguments and debates. So when people debate an issue like abortion or euthanasia or whatever else it may be, taking your favorite contentious or issue and so on, one thing that has struck me quite forcibly, actually, is that for all that we think of ourselves as modernist and progressive and have moved forward in one thing and another, and that actually the expectations of argument are medieval. They're ancient and medieval. So to explain what I mean, let me just say this. There's the model of argument, strictly, that you get in Aristotle and then in the medieval Aristotelians and so on, is what's known as a demonstration. Now, a demonstration, strictly speaking, is an argument that has the following features. Its premises, certainly its major premise, probably its might, well, let's just say its premises are self-evident, or at least one, or its main premise is self-evident. And the inference is deductive. So what that means is that the premise or premises are indubitable, and a deductive inference is characterized in terms of its being truth-preserving. So in a deductive inference, if the premises are true, the conclusion cannot but be true. That's what makes an inference deductive. So here's a model of argument. You start out with self-evident premises, right? You look upon the premise and you consider that. You think, yeah, that couldn't fail to be the case. And then you, so you're certain about the premise. That's what it really means in this context, for it to be self-evident. There can be no doubt about the matter. And then you proceed deductively. And so the conclusion ought to inherit the certainty of the premise. So what do you think in the circumstance in which you're arguing with somebody and you've put the premises in front of them, and you've argued deductively, and they don't agree with your conclusion? Well, they're either stupid or wicked, right? I mean, they're either willfully refusing to embrace the entailed conclusion of those premises, or they're stupid and can't reason, right? So they can't draw the inference. Or they're stupid because they can't recognize the indubitability of the major premise or premises. Now, if you think about the kind of debates that we have now in the United States and Britain around these controversial issues, that's exactly the character that these take on, right? So to put it rather crudely, and it is crude, liberals think of conservatives as stupid, and conservatives think of liberals as wicked, right? So if you take the kind of, you know, sometimes, of course, each thinks of the other as both stupid and wicked, right? So their failure is overdetermined in this respect. But just think about that. I mean, this is what it's like, right? When you look at these arguments, one side think the other, they're just stupid conservatives. They don't kind of, you know, or they're, you know, they're from... I mean, notice how, for example, in the following the election, so much was made of the educational levels of those who voted for Trump versus those who voted for Hillary, right? So you've just got to be stupid to vote for. Now, you know, we would debate that. But anyway, you've got to be stupid to vote in that sort of way. Or more generally, you've got to be stupid to be a conservative. Or, but equally, the other side of that is these liberals are just bad people, right? They're just immoral people, you know? They don't recognize what's wrong with abortion. They don't recognize the goodness of same-sex marriage and so on. Which way, I don't know who's talking about whom now. Yeah, this is the conservative. Mike, is this the conservative? Yeah, they're wicked people, right? That response suggests to me that people are thinking of arguments in these areas as being effectively demonstrations. Of course, they've never heard of the idea of a strict demonstration, but they're thinking that argument in moral matters is like that, right? You just have to see the truth of the premises and then, you know, reason coherently, and then you'll embrace the conclusion. So if you're not embracing the conclusion, you're either not seeing the truth or you can't reason. Now, here's the thing then to say is this. No serious argument around a moral or social issue is a demonstration. There are no demonstrations. What I mean by that is, in these areas, there are no self-evident premises. Right? There's nothing that's self-evident at that level. So the idea that, you know, a certain kind of sexual relations are superior to other kinds is not self-evident. Right? Whatever you think. So let's take one of these issues. Look, take the abortion debate. There are reasonable arguments on either side of the abortion debate. It would just be a dereliction of intellectual responsibility to recognize that there are serious, reasonable arguments on either side of the abortion debate. Now, I myself am, I suppose, what gets called a pro-lifer, right? But nonetheless, the point is, I don't think for a moment that people who argue on the other side of that are necessarily either stupid or wicked, right? Likewise, on the questions, let's say, less controversial now, but still as well, at least warm, if not hot, issue about same-sex marriage. Of course there are arguments of a reasonable sort in favor of same-sex marriage. I've argued publicly against same-sex marriage, but I recognize that there are reasonable arguments in favor of same-sex marriage. It would just be crazy, right? But likewise, there are reasonable arguments against same-sex marriage, right? And I think people just don't want to accept that. If you're on one or other of the side of that debate, you don't want to accept that there are reasonable arguments on the other side. And so what you're driven to do is to regard your opponent as either stupid or wicked. Right? They're just either not seeing it because they don't have the intellectual competence, or they're willfully refusing to draw the correct conclusion from the premises. Now, I need to say, this is not relativism. I'm not saying there isn't. So to recognize there can be a reasonable argument in favor of a conclusion is not to accept the conclusion of that argument. Right? Reasonability is one thing, truth is another. But I think that one thing that we need to understand if we're going to understand these debates in any way to forward to resolution is that no ethical debate of the kind examples that I've given you so far will be resolved in isolation from something much larger. Right? That what happens when you're trying to debate an issue or think about an issue like that, you're bringing something like the totality of your experience and reflection to bear. Right? So, you know, just take any argument in which the notion of a human being features, as in one of the premises. Right? The term human being is a theoretical term, right? It's not an observational term. I mean, it's related to observation and so on. But a lot is brought to bear in the concept of a human being, including concepts of value and so on. It's not an easy or trivial matter to understand, in the relevant ethical sense, what a human being is. That's not to say there isn't an understanding to be had, or indeed that there's a correct understanding to be had, but it's not a trivial matter. And it's not done in isolation from other things that you think. So really, the part of our the possibility of moving forward here, I think, depends in part on, as it were, moving away from the issues themselves. Now, of course, we can't do that because the issues are live and they're before us and so on. But to some extent, actually shifting the ground to somewhere else, to try to work more extensively towards developing shared concepts, or I most strictly could say shared conceptions, because what you often get is that people share a concept, let's say the concept of justice, but they've got different conceptions of what justice involves or what it amounts to. So there's a lot of work to be done in putting things back together again. Now, if I'm right about the relative position of practice in relation to ideas, a lot of that work actually has to be done not at the level of intellectual argumentation, but at the level of praxis or practice, right? That people who have certain ethical ideas and values before them have to show to other people the lived validity of those ideas, if you like, right? They have to demonstrate through life the value of those ideas, not as abstract notions, but actually as something that one can live by, and that something that is an ennobling conception of what it is to be human, and something which you can persuade others is an ennobling conception of what it is to be human. So, for example, we're just too close to the history that has produced the breakdown of marriage to have a serious argument around marriage, because our lived experience of marriage is so diverse and fractured and broken that there isn't a common concept or anything like a common concept at work. We have the illusion of a common concept because of the residue of a word, right? But actually that word means different things to different people. And many people have stopped thinking about what it means at all. It's just become an instrument with which to beat somebody else over the head one way or another. So I said I wouldn't be offering solutions. There is a great deal more I could say, and I don't mind, you know, we can touch on some of these matters as the time for questions. But what I'm trying to suggest is that really we need to, as it were, step back and try to understand what's brought us to the condition and the situation in which we find ourselves today. I'll just give one further example, actually, which is interesting. The issue of immigration in Europe and in the United States is not unconnected with Islam, clearly, right? Whatever the complexity of those relations, it's not unconnected with Islam. Why are people fearful of the Islamicization of Europe, for example? Well, I don't think there's any easy answer to that question. I mean, some people think it's just racism, for example. I don't think it is racism. I mean, I've no doubt there are elements of racism in there, but I think it's much deeper and more complex. I think part of it, never spoken of, is the sense of Western Europe as itself a failed project. That actually the Islamic peoples that are making their way into Western Europe have a much more integrated conception of their own values and culture that is true of the recipient nations. And so in a sense, they represent a challenge to a kind of faithless people, right? So the witness of faithful people to a faithless people is always uncomfortable, right? Obviously, it is true that many in the Islamic world despise the West, not because of its imperialism, but because of its liberalism, right? And that is something that's going to have to be negotiated, right? Many Islamic peoples think of the Western treatment of women and women's display of themselves as disgraceful, shameful, right? A debasement of the dignity of the human body. Now think of how in the Western world people used to say that the body was the temple of the Holy Spirit, right? That notion of a sanctified conception of the human body. And think how far we've come from that conception. And now imagine the meetings of a people who still hold something like that conception. And then they look at Western Europe and they see it as a degraded human body, a body that has no dignity. If we are to understand what's going on here, we do need to have a much deeper cultural and historical understanding of the forces that have brought us to where we are today, as well as, of course, the forces that have brought others to where they are. I'm going to stop now. Thank you very much indeed. Right. People talk about the long 19th century. That was a long 40 minutes, but it wasn't that long.
We'll let Dr. Haldane have some water for a minute and recover, and then you'll take some questions.
This is water? All right. That's okay. I'm at Baylor, so I'm used to that. Yeah. Yeah. Tankery water, I think, yeah. No, blue sapphire water, sorry. No. Yes, please.
What's the place of things like debates and rational arguments about same-sex marriage, abortion, these sorts of hot topics, if it's primarily about living the lives? And you said we're too close to the breakdown of marriage to have an argument about that.
Well, I mean, sorry, was that the end of the question? Yeah, I mean, I don't... Let me make one thing clear. I did sort of say this, but I just need to emphasize it. I'm not suggesting that we just suspend all discussion, right? That's not an option, okay? But I do think that we need to understand more deeply, you know, what's going on here. So there's a periodical, which some of you will know, called First Things. Some of you know First Things? Yeah. Does anybody know First Things? It's quite a part. Yeah, okay. So some years, I don't know how many years ago, not that long ago, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, 2 or 3, I can't remember. I wrote an article in there, which I don't think this was my title, but anyway, it was the title it was given. It was called Against Erotic Entitlement. In it, I sort of set out an argument, what I call the argumentum ad consummationem, an argument to consummation. And the first premise is, sort of affection and sexual fulfillment are intrinsic parts of a good human life. These things are not open to being chosen. You know, you don't choose what sexual attraction you feel in one thing or another and so on. So the fulfillment of these ought to be part of, wherever they're authentically felt, it ought to be part of a fulfilled human life. And the challenge was really to say what's wrong with that argument. I ought to set it as a competition, you know, prize winners will get such and such. But it is interesting, I mean, see, opponents of same-sex marriage don't really appreciate the extent to which if you want to look at, I mean, opponents of same-sex marriage who think that same-sex marriage is a threat to the institution of marriage just need to have a little look at the history of heterosexual marriage in the 20th century, right? If anybody destroyed marriage in the 20th century, it was the heterosexuals, right? If anything, the homosexuals are actually kind of sentimentalists, right? They are sort of grasping for a notion of fulfillment in marriage that is, you know, almost Victorian, right? I mean, it craves public recognition, for example, public approbation and so on. So it is like, you know, the great movement in the 19th century to move away from common law marriage relationships to actually, you know, properly registered and recognized relationships. And it's interesting when David Cameron, who was then leader of the Conservative Party but not yet Prime Minister, said, you know, I'm in favor of same-sex marriage, not in spite of being a Conservative, but because I'm a Conservative. And I think that gave voice to an idea that is actually quite widespread, right? That actually marriage is a very conservative institution. And so, you know, isn't that good that people want to be married and such like? Well, you know, when you sort of think about that, you think, well, hang on a second, I just need to get a little clearer about these ideas, because this is just now moving in every possible direction. So I don't think that we can just suspend having debates about things like marriage. But I do think that we're not well equipped to have those debates until we've actually thought through a little about the history of marriage as an institution and where it's right, and also sorted out the extent and the ways in which we realize, I mean, actualize in our own lives the conception of marriage that we claim to hold fast to, right? So you've got a lot of people, you know, avowing a certain conception of marriage that bears no resemblance to their own performance in that particular role, right? So there is a lot of kind of bad faith and false consciousness in these matters. So I think we do have to go on having the arguments. I think we do have to go on trying to fashion the concepts. But I do think we need to also to enrich our understanding, first of all, what an argument is. It's not a demonstration. It's bringing to bear the totality of one's understanding and experience. It's also connecting one's ideas with one's actions, and also correcting simultaneously one's actions in light of one's ideas. So there's a kind of process of mutual determination here between thought and action. And that's really what I guess I'm saying. Yeah.
So I think following on what you were just saying there, I was quite interested by this part of the talk where you talked about what happens in a disagreement, especially you brought in the idea of a demonstration.
Yeah.
And you said people oftentimes think that if you fail to disagree, it must be because either someone is stupid,
yeah,
they can't follow the inferences,
yeah,
so they don't
recognize the premise is correct. Yeah.
Then you made a really interesting point. You
said, oh.
But reasonability is not the same as truth.
Yes.
And so if we think that our intellects are in some way geared towards the truth, it,
yeah,
seems like if we don't agree that there's still some sort of cognitive failure.
Oh, yes. Well, yeah.
And so if the cognitive failure is not a failure of reasonableness or, yeah, a failure of wickedness, well, how can we describe,
yeah,
that failure in a way that,
okay,
might help us?
Yeah, I don't have a blackboard, do I? No, okay. So let me just say three things very briefly, but they're really the names of chapters rather than they're sort of, you're right, okay. So there's a very important essay was published, I think, I can't remember, 1956 or something of that sort. And it's an essay I would, to anybody who's interested in social, ethical, political thought of a philosophical kind of orientation, this is a must read. It's by W.B. Galley. Can anybody complete that? No, it's called Essentially Contested Concepts. And Galley makes a discovery there, I suppose you might say, this idea of the essentially contested concept. And what he's pointing out is that there are certain concepts, or ranges of concepts, the application of which is not determined in the way that certain other sort of concepts are determined, right? So, you know, we have criteria of Marx as whether something's a living thing or not, right? Those are agreed. I mean, we might have, you know, some theoretical puzzlement about the nature of life, but for practical purposes, right, we have criteria for death, okay? I mean, there are some ethical questions about brain death as against, you know, whole body death and so on, but nonetheless, right, there are criteria for death. So, you know, it's not as if doctors go, I don't know you, what do you think, right? You know what I mean? maybe he's dead, I don't really know, I can't find this very difficult, I don't understand the concept of death. No, it doesn't work like that, right? Yeah. Its premises, certainly its major premise, probably its might, well, let's just say its premises are self-evident, or at least one, or its main premise is self-evident. And the inference is deductive. So what that means is that the premise or premises are indubitable, and a deductive inference is characterize in terms of it being truth-preserving. So in a deductive inference, if the premises are true, the conclusion cannot but be true. That's what makes an inference deductive. So here's a model of argument. You start out with self-evident premises, right? You look upon the premise and you consider that, and you think, yeah, that couldn't fail to be the case. And then you, so you're certain about the premise, that's what it really means in this context, for it to be self-evident, there can be no doubt about the matter. And then you proceed deductively, and so the conclusion ought to inherit the certainty of the premise. So what do you think in the circumstance in which you're arguing with somebody and you've put the premises in front of them and you've argued deductively and they don't agree with your conclusion? Well, they're either stupid or wicked, right? I mean, they're either willfully refusing to embrace the entailed conclusion of those premises, or they're stupid and can't reason, right? So they can't draw the inference, or they're stupid because they can't recognize the indubitability of the major premise or premises. Now, if you think about the kind of debates that we have now in the United States and Britain around these controversial issues, that's exactly the character that these take on, right? So to put it rather crudely, and it is crude, liberals think of conservatives as stupid, and conservatives think of liberals as wicked, right? So if you take the kind of, you know, sometimes, of course, each thinks of the other as both stupid and wicked, right? So their failure is overdetermined in this respect. But just think about that. I mean, this is what it's like, right? When you look at these arguments, one side think the other, they're just stupid conservatives. They don't kind of, you know, or they're, you know, they're from... I mean, notice how, for example, in the following the election, so much was made of the educational levels of those who voted for Trump versus those who voted for Hillary, right? So it's, you've just got to be stupid to vote for. Now, you know, we'd debate that. But anyway, you've got to be stupid to vote in that sort of way. Or more generally, you've got to be stupid to be a conservative. Or like, but equally, the other side of that is these liberals are just bad people, right? They're just immoral people, you know? They don't recognize what's wrong with abortion. They don't recognize the goodness of same-sex marriage and so on. Which way, I don't know who's talking about whom now. Yeah, is this the conservative? Mike, is this the conservative? Yeah, they're wicked people, right? Now, that response suggests to me that people are thinking of arguments in these areas as being effectively demonstrations. Of course, they've never heard of the idea of a strict demonstration, but they're thinking that argument in moral matters is like that, right? You just have to see the truth of the premises and then, you know, reason coherently, and then you'll embrace the conclusion. So if you're not embracing the conclusion, you're either not seeing the truth or you can't reason. Now, here's the thing then to say is this. No serious argument around a moral or social issue is a demonstration. There are no demonstrations. What I mean by that is, in these areas, there are no self-evident premises. Right? There's nothing that's self-evident at that level. So the idea that, you know, a certain kind of sexual relations are superior to other kinds is not self-evident, right? Whatever you think. So let's take one of these issues. Look, take the abortion debate. There are reasonable arguments on either side of the abortion debate. It would just be a dereliction of intellectual responsibility to recognize that there are serious, reasonable arguments on either side of the abortion debate. Now, I myself am, I suppose, what gets called a pro-lifer, right? But nonetheless, the point is, I don't think for a moment that people who argue on the other side of that are necessarily either stupid or wicked, right? Likewise, on the questions, let's say, less controversial now, but still, as well, at least warm, if not hot, issue about same-sex marriage. Of course there are arguments of a reasonable sort in favor of same-sex marriage. I've argued publicly against same-sex marriage, but I recognize that there are reasonable arguments in favor of same-sex marriage. It would just be crazy, right? But likewise, there are reasonable arguments against same-sex marriage, right? And I think people just don't want to accept that. If you're on one or other of the side of that debate, you don't want to accept that there are reasonable arguments on the other side. And so what you're driven to do is to regard your opponent as either stupid or wicked, right? They're just either not seeing it because they don't have the intellectual competence, or they're willfully refusing to draw the correct conclusion from the premises. Now, I need to say this is not relativism. I'm not saying there isn't. So to recognize there can be a reasonable argument in favor of a conclusion is not to accept the conclusion of that argument. Right? Reasonability is one thing, truth is another. But I think that one thing that we need to understand if we're going to understand these debates in any way to forward to resolution is that no ethical debate of the kind I've, the examples that I've given you so far, will be resolved in isolation from something much larger, right? That what happens when you're trying to debate an issue or think about an issue like that, you're bringing something like the totality of your experience and reflection to bear, right? So, you know, just take any argument in which the notion of a human being features, as in one of the premises, right? The term human being is a theoretical term, right? It's not an observational term. I mean, it's related to observation and so on. But a lot is brought to bear in the concept of a human being, including concepts of value and so on. It's not an easy or trivial matter to understand, in the relevant ethical sense, what a human being is. That's not to say there isn't an understanding to be had, or indeed that there's a correct understanding to be had, but it's not a trivial matter. And it's not done in isolation from other things that you think. So really, the part of our the possibility of moving forward here, I think, depends in part on, as it were, moving away from the issues themselves. Now, of course, we can't do that because the issues are live and they're before us and so on. But to some extent, actually shifting the ground to somewhere else, to try to work more extensively towards developing shared concepts, or I most strictly could say shared conceptions, because what you often get is that people share a concept, let's say the concept of justice, but they've got different conceptions of what justice involves or what it amounts to. So there's a lot of work to be done in putting things back together again. Now, if I'm right about the relative position of practice in relation to ideas, a lot of that work actually has to be done not at the level of intellectual argumentation, but at the level of praxis or practice, right? That people who have certain ethical ideas and values before them have to show to other people the lived validity of those ideas, if you like, right? They have to demonstrate through life the value of those ideas, not as abstract notions, but actually as something that one can live by, and that something that is an ennobling conception of what it is to be human, and something which you can persuade others is an ennobling conception of what it is to be human. So, for example, we're just too close to the history that has produced the breakdown of marriage to have a serious argument around marriage, because our lived experience of marriage is so diverse and fractured and broken that there isn't a common concept or anything like a common concept at work. We have the illusion of a common concept because the residue of a word, right? But actually that word means different things to different people. And many people have stopped thinking about what it means at all. It's just become an instrument with which to beat somebody else over the head one way or another. So I said I wouldn't be offering solutions. There is a great deal more I could say, and I don't mind, you know, we can touch on some of these matters as the time for questions. But what I'm trying to suggest is that really we need to, as it were, step back and try to understand what's brought us to the condition and the situation in which we find ourselves today. I'll just give one further example, actually, which is interesting. The issue of immigration in Europe and in the United States is not unconnected with Islam, clearly, right? Whatever the complexity of those relations, it's not unconnected with Islam. Why are people fearful of the Islamicization of Europe, for example? Well, I don't think there's any easy answer to that question. I mean, some people think it's just racism, for example. I don't think it is racism. I mean, I've no doubt there are elements of racism in there, but I think it's much deeper and more complex. I think part of it, never spoken of, is the sense of Western Europe as itself a failed project. Right? That actually the Islamic peoples that are making their way into Western Europe have a much more integrated conception of their own values and culture that is true of the recipient nations. And so in a sense, they represent a challenge to a kind of faithless people, right? So the witness of faithful people to a faithless people is always uncomfortable, right? Obviously, it is true that many in the Islamic world despise the West, not because of its imperialism, but because of its liberalism, right? And that is something that's going to have to be negotiated, right? Many Islamic peoples think of the Western treatment of women and women's display of themselves as disgraceful, shameful, right? A debasement of the dignity of the human body. Now think of how in the Western world people used to say that the body was the temple of the Holy Spirit, right? That notion of a sanctified conception of the human body. And think how far we've come from that conception. And now imagine the meetings of a people who still hold something like that conception. And then they look at Western Europe and they see it as a degraded human body, a body that has no dignity. If we are to understand what's going on here, we do need to have a much deeper cultural and historical understanding of the forces that have brought us to where we are today, as well as, of course, the forces that have brought others to where they are. I'm going to stop now. Thank you very much indeed. Right. People talk about the long 19th century. That was a long 40 minutes, but it wasn't that long.
Dr. Haldane, have some water for a minute and recover, and then
you'll
take some questions.
This is water? All right. That's okay. I'm at Baylor, so I'm used to that. Yeah. Yeah. Tankery water, I think. Yeah. No, blue sapphire water, sorry. Yeah. Yes, please.
What's the place of things like debates and rational arguments about same-sex marriage, abortion, these sorts of hot topics, if it's primarily about living the lives? And you said we're too close to the breakdown of marriage to have an argument about that.
Well, I mean, sorry, was that the end of the question? Yeah, I mean, I don't, let me make one thing clear. I did sort of say this, but I just need to emphasize it. I'm not suggesting that we just suspend all discussion, right? That's not an option, okay? But I do think that we need to understand more deeply, you know, what's going on here. So there's a periodical, which some of you will know, called First Things. Some of you know First Things? Yeah. Does anybody know First Things? It's quite a part. Yeah, okay. So some years, I don't know how many years ago, well, not that long ago, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, 2 or 3, I can't remember. I wrote an article in there, which I don't think this was my title, but at any rate, it was the title it was given. It was called Against Erotic Entitlement. In it, I sort of set out an argument, what I call the argumentum ad consummationem, an argument to consummation. And the first premise is, sort of affection and sexual fulfillment are intrinsic parts of a good human life. These things are not open to being chosen. You know, you don't choose what sexual attraction you feel in one thing or another and so on. So the fulfillment of these ought to be part of, wherever they're authentically felt, it ought to be part of a fulfilled human life. And the challenge was really to say what's wrong with that argument. I ought to set it as a competition, you know, prize winners will get such and such. But it is interesting, I mean, see, opponents of same-sex marriage don't really appreciate the extent to which, if you want to look at, I mean, opponents of same-sex marriage who think that same-sex marriage is a threat to the institution of marriage just need to have a little look at the history of heterosexual marriage in the 20th century, right? If anybody destroyed marriage in the 20th century, it was the heterosexuals, right? If anything, the homosexuals are actually kind of sentimentalists, right? They are sort of grasping for a notion of fulfillment in marriage that is, you know, almost Victorian, right? I mean, it craves public recognition, for example, public approbation and so on. So it is like, you know, the great movement in the 19th century to move away from common law marriage relationships to actually, you know, properly registered and recognized relationships. And it's interesting when David Cameron, who was then leader of the Conservative Party but not yet Prime Minister, said, you know, I'm in favor of same-sex marriage, not in spite of being a Conservative, but because I'm a Conservative. And I think that gave voice to an idea that is actually quite widespread, right? That actually marriage is a very conservative institution. And so, you know, isn't that good that people want to be married and such like? Well, you know, when you sort of think about that, you think, well, hang on a second, I just need to get a little clearer about these ideas because this is just now moving in every possible direction. So I don't think that we can just suspend having debates about things like marriage. But I do think that we're not well equipped to have those debates until we've actually thought through a little about the history of marriage as an institution and where it's right, and also sorted out the extent and the ways in which we realize, I mean, actualize in our own lives the conception of marriage that we claim to hold fast to, right? So you've got a lot of people, you know, avowing a certain conception of marriage that bears no resemblance to their own performance in that particular role, right? So there is a lot of kind of bad faith and false consciousness in these matters. So I think we do have to go on having the arguments. I think we do have to go on trying to fashion the concepts. But I do think we need to also to enrich our understanding, first of all, what an argument is. It's not a demonstration. It's bringing to bear the totality of one's understanding and experience. It's also connecting one's ideas with one's actions, and also correcting simultaneously one's actions in light of one idea, of one's ideas. So there's a kind of process of mutual determination here between thought and action. And that's really what I guess I'm saying. Yeah.
So I think following on what you were just saying there, I was quite interested by this part of the talk where you talked about what happens in a disagreement, especially you brought in the idea of demonstration.
Yeah.
And you said people oftentimes think that if you fail to disagree, it must be because either someone is stupid,
yeah,
they can't follow the inferences,
yeah,
or they don't
recognize the premise is correct. Yeah.
And then you made a really interesting point.
Oh.
Reasonability is not the same as truth.
Yes.
And so if we think that our intellects are in some way geared towards the truth, it,
yeah,
seems like if we don't agree, that there's still some sort of cognitive failure.
Oh, yes. Well, yeah.
And so if the cognitive failure is not a failure of reasonableness or, yeah, a failure of wickedness, well, how can we describe,
yeah,
that failure in a way that,
okay,
might help us?
Yeah, I don't have a blackboard, do I? No, okay. So let me just say three things very briefly, but they're really the names of chapters rather than they're sort of, you're right, okay. So there's a very important essay was published, I think, I can't remember, 1956 or something of that sort. And it's an essay I would, to anybody who's interested in social, ethical, political thought of a philosophical kind of orientation, this is a must read. It's by W.B. Galley. Can anybody complete that? No, it's called, anyway, it's called Essentially Contested Concepts. And Galley makes a discovery there, I suppose you might say, this idea of the essentially contested concept. And what he's pointing out is that there are certain concepts, or ranges of concepts, the application of which is not determined in the way that certain other sorts of concepts are determined, right? So, you know, we have criteria of Marx as whether something's a living thing or not, right? Those are agreed. I mean, we might have, you know, some theoretical puzzlement about the nature of life, but for practical purposes, right, we have criteria for death, okay? I mean, there are some ethical questions about brain death as against, you know, whole body death and so on, but nonetheless, right, there are criteria for death. So, you know, it's not as if doctors go, I don't know, you, what do you think, right? You know what I mean? maybe he's dead, I don't really know, I can't find this very difficult, I don't understand the concept of death. No, it doesn't work like that, right? Yeah. Just deep sleep, yeah. But there are concepts for which there are no specified confirmation procedures in that sense, and these are essentially contested concepts. So, you know, we all believe in justice, yeah, but we don't all believe what justice. We don't all agree about what justice is. It's one of those concepts that, in arguments, you'll find that part of what you're arguing about is not just whether this is a case of justice, but what justice is and what's valuable about justice and what priority it has over equality or freedom and so on and such like. Okay, essentially contested concepts. Second idea that's worth getting hold of. So I'm just trying to think of the brief version. Okay, so in semantics, in the theory of meaning, one question that is central, has been central really since Frege in the 19th century, is something like, what is the unit of meaning? Is it the word or is it the sentence, for example? So what's the relationship between the meaning of a sentence and the meaning of its component words? So on some views, the meaning of a sentence is just a function of the meanings of the words that compose it, right? So the word has priority, in a sense, right? On other views, the meaning a word has is given by its role in a sentence. So it's the sentence that has priority. Now, I'm not going to turn this into a lecture on the philosophy of language, but let me just say this, that one thing I think we've come to see is that many words have their meaning through the network of generalizations in which they feature. So what I mean by that is this. If you want to know what an electron is, for example, the meaning of the word electron, clearly, you can't do, I mean, I know electron microscopes and all the rest of it, but you can't do that observationally. Electron is not an observation term, right? It's a theoretical term. And so the meaning of the word electron is given by the theories in which it features. Or here's another rather radical case, actually. Do parallel lines meet? Well, one of the definitions of parallel lines is that they don't meet. But in non-Euclidean geometries, parallel lines can cross. They can cross, if they're infinitely extended, they can cross and recross infinitely many times, right? So the meaning of the expression parallel line is given by the theories in which it features, by the geometries in which it features. And the meaning of that term can change according to the geometrical theories within which it's being expressed. Now, I think that all significant concepts have that character. All significant concepts are partly theoretical concepts. So if you want to know what that means, you have to see the generalizations in which it features, right? You have to see the theory. Every significant term is a theoretical term. So that's another reason why we're having difficulties. What you're getting are two different theories meeting. That sounds like they're using the same word. They are using the same word. It doesn't follow the word they're using has the same meaning because they're different theories, right? And then the third thing is a puzzle that's currently a subject of quite a bit of philosophical discussion, which is called peer disagreement. And the issue here is, what do you make of the situation in which people, two of you are disagreeing about some judgment or other, and you recognize the other two to be a peer, right? I mean, it's a mutual recognition of one another as peers. So you recognize that the other person is equally competent, right? So there's two of you. You don't presume that one of you is more competent than the other, and yet they disagree. You disagree. Now, this is a very interesting, this happens all the time, actually. Peer disagreement is quite an interesting phenomenon, right? It's in the law, it's in science, and one thing and another. What do we say about these situations? Well, one thing we could say is there's no truth of the matter, right? If we were just, there is no fact of the matter here. You know, it's opinion, it's sentiment, or whatever. It doesn't really matter what your story is, right? But there's no truth. But I'm taking it as part of the situation of peer disagreement that both parties to this think there is a truth of the matter. So they're agreed there is a truth of the matter, and they're agreed that they're equally competent, and yet they're disagreeing. How to explain peer disagreement? It's a very interesting question. Now, obviously, one easy way out would be to say, well, he isn't really my peer, right? He's not as confident as me, because I know what the answer is. He's got it wrong, so he's not as confident, right? But that's a sort of slide back into the kind of a version of the wicked or stupid, right? Probably stupid, maybe wicked, or, you know, anyway. Academics are generally wicked. And they're also stupid as well. That's true, yeah. Okay, but what I mean is it's going to be a combination of those. So that's another phenomenon. So we've got to peer disagreement as a fact in science, in law, and so on. So I think there is truth. I'm not any kind of relativist. I just think truth is a lot harder to achieve than we might have thought it was. And secondly, I think that part of the distance of getting from here to truth has to be crossed existentially, as it were, by our activities, not just by our thoughts, right? That we won't be well disposed to determine the truth of a matter until we are well disposed in our behavior with regard to that subject matter more generally. And one aspect of contemporary cultures, which seems to be pretty obvious, is the extent of psychic disorder in people's lives, right? I mean, you only need to talk to the counselors in colleges and universities and so on, student counseling, the extent to which, you know, America and Europe is on various forms of medication, widespread degrees of depression and so on and such like. You know, we are a disordered generation or generations in all sorts of ways. And I think everybody knows that. Just a final remark of that. Some years ago, I used to write a column for the Times, the London Times. It was a monthly column, and I did it for about 3-4 years, which it completely exhausted me, I have to say. But at any rate, because you run out of ideas and you don't want to, anyway, doesn't it? Journalism, or that kind of journalism, is a lot harder than you might think. But at any rate, the articles that brought in, you know, the serious flow of mail were always articles that touched on the human condition and its brokenness. You know, so for example, some of you will remember the words of Thoreau, the mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation. The mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation. If you just touch the surface of people's lives in ways that touch on matters, you know, of infidelity, sexual abuse, alcoholism, depression, you know, disappointment, brokenness, regret, rage, anger, unforgiveness, alienation, and so on, it's just all there. Right? Now, would you expect creatures who are that, you know, to use a technical expression, messed up, to be very good at sort of thinking about the human condition? No. That was a rhetorical question, right?
Okay, there you are. It's a happy note, isn't it?
Yeah. Always leave them on a happy, uplifting note. Yeah, right.
Right.
Yes, sorry, please.
So back at the beginning, you touched on
Yeah. Yeah.
And where to go?
Well, providence or luck have made it the case that for me, for most of my life, I've lived at least part of the year, if not all the year, quite close to the sea. And now I'm living in north central Texas, right? or at least part of the year. There is something. I mean, this is to speak to the rural, right? There is something about being in an environment that is unchanging, or relatively speaking. I mean, it's got its own dynamic of weather and motion and tide and growth and season and one thing and another. But all of that is within a kind of cyclical regularity, right? The rate of change is slow in that kind of environment. And I think against that background, you measure your life differently, right? I mean, you see your life differently, and you measure your life differently, and you measure it in terms of those kinds of organic, cyclical processes. If you live in a city, you know, which is just a kind of flickering condition all the time, and particularly, actually, I was mentioning this to somebody earlier on, you know, with 24-hour, seven-day-a-week news, right, it fabricates disagreement and uncertainty and change and so on, right? I mean, because there isn't enough news to go around, so you've got to kind of give this, you know, you see these kind of breaking news, all this stuff, you know. That adds another a sense of a kind of dislocation, disruption, brokenness. And the news is always kind of, you know, this fighting happened here, bombing was there, these people are, you know, such and such. So I do think that the experience of nature in the broader sense of that, but even including sort of, you know, urbanized nature, public parks and so on. I used at one point to teach in an architecture school and have written about architecture and so on. But I'm very interested in the, I mean, French, okay, architecture talk coming on, resist, okay. The interplay, I mean, a common feature as urbanization begins to develop in architecture is the interplay of the garden and the house, right? And the way in which people start to seek to create, as it were, nature within their space, right? Whether it be, I mean, a grand architectural scheme in which there's a sort of faux nature there, you know, I mean, it's all landscape, but it looks like it's wild sort of thing, that kind of thing. Or it's just people cultivating their gardens. There is a, I mean, if I ruled the world, and it's only a matter of time, then I think I would make more garden space and more public space of that kind, you know, where people would just watch things grow. And then these are activities in which people can share, apart from their ideological differences and so on. You know, it's a great way of making friendships, actually. Just as is dog walking and things of that sort, right? You know. Anyway, now I feel like I'm giving tips for, you know, marriage or something of that sort. So I think this is now the time to stop before this. Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Haldane, for joining us this evening. Dr. Haldane's invitation to us to seek clarity about complexity, not only intellectually, but in terms of seeking a lived validity of ideas, ties closely into the mission of the Agora Institute. As many of you know from previous Agora events, right? In many ancient Greek cities, the Agora was an open public space. Public space, there we go. Where citizens came together to exchange goods and ideas. They did not see any conflict and indeed affirmed necessary connection among political, commercial, social, and religious ideas and concerns. Here at the Agora Institute, we seek to foster such public discourse in a contemporary milieu that has all but abandoned the attempt to consider such ideas together. In an age of polarization and specialization, open debate in the public square, debate which requires a fundamental acknowledgement of difference and willingness to listen to and respectfully engage with those with whom we disagree has become increasingly rare. But the Agora Institute believes that it is only in returning to the ideal of such dialogue that we will be able to recover an essential tradition of civic virtue, the habits and practices that allow us to live and seek flourishing together. The Institute was created to affirm a notion of the common good and to form our commitment to pursue it together through vigorous discourse, hopefully resulting in joint and passionate action. Dr. Haldane's message tonight has, I am sure, given us much to think about in terms of how such a project might be carried forward and understood. I would like to thank him again for joining us, and to thank all of you for your commitment to partnering with the Agora Institute, the Templeton Honors College, and Eastern University, and pursuing this project together. Thanks so much for coming, everyone.
I'm going to go to the next one.